Welcome to the Daily Glasgow Cappuccino. Start each day of COP26 by drinking in a few minutes of warm, stimulating conversation about climate resilience. I'm your host, Peter Willis from The Resilience Shift. Shall we begin? I have with me three very special guests for this morning's cappuccino, which is the first in the series that runs through COP26. They are Nathaniel Matthews, Chief Executive Officer of the Global Resilience Partnership, Kathy Boffman-McLeod, who directs the Adrian Arsht Rockefeller Foundation Resilience Center, and Seth Schultz, who's the Chief Executive Officer of the Resilience Shift. Nate, Seth, Kathy, welcome. It's lovely to have you here on this first cappuccino. And I'm going to ask you, Nate, if you would help our cappuccino drinkers here to understand what is the Resilience Hub at COP26. I believe it was your idea, and we'd love to hear what it is and why it is.
The Hub was really born at the last COP in COP25 in Madrid. And when we realized that aspects of resilience were everywhere, but nowhere in a sense. So every country had thematic pavilions, for example, nature, but no one central place to pull these together. And we had things like a resilience roundtable, but it was clear that there was a strong community around action on adaptation and resilience, and we needed to come together across various lines. So we started socializing it in early 2020 with David Hallett, our then policy lead, and when he was seconded into the champions. And then it started to crystallize throughout late 2020 and into 2021 with a solid concept and bringing partners on board, key partners like the Atlantic Council and the Resilience Shift, of course. And it's really about, you know, connecting across themes, since resilience requires a whole of systems approach, and providing one hub where we could really advance resilience actions and help move forward discussions on adaptation and resilience. And then secondly, for us, the really big focus is on inclusivity. So it was just critical. COP is a big, complex, and often inaccessible, especially to small organizations. So even prior to the COVID pandemic, we realized that participation for community-based organizations was going to be a huge barrier. We wanted to get grassroots, elevate those voices into the discussions. So we decided to, you know, work together and design this resilience hub as a window where we have hubs in the Pacific, Southeast Asia, South Asia, Africa, Latin America, Caribbean, and really, you know, focus on these interactions and bringing voices in and actively feeding into important discussions and action on the ground. And I think today we're up to over 140 events, over 80 partners engaged physically and virtually. I heard it's one of the biggest virtual events globally ever. Potentially, and it's certainly the biggest event at COP on adaptation and resilience.
Kathy, why did you bring the Atlantic Council into this partnership? What are you seeing for this resilience hub?
Well, the Adrian Arsht Rockefeller Foundation Resilience Center at the Atlantic Council has pledged to reach 1 billion people with resilient solutions to climate impacts by 2030. And the Resilience Hub is the perfect place to advance these interventions that are protecting people and economies. And we all know that about 93% of climate finance goes to climate mitigation and the energy transition. And we also know that we see impacts growing and the pain and suffering across the world is increasing in heat waves and floods and fires and drought, food insecurity. We need to increase the focus, the awareness, the understanding, the breadth and depth of the interventions for adaptation and increase the sophistication and ultimately the finance, the investment into these things that help protect people. And so the Resilience Hub, with all of its partners and its initiatives, is an opportunity to bring climate adaptation on par with the focus that the world has on climate mitigation. Both are important. We need to attack both with equal vigor and rigor.
And Seth, can you paint a picture for us of what your highest ambition, your highest hope is for this hub during the 2 weeks in Glasgow?
I mean, I think we have a shared purpose amongst the organizations and many of the partners who are across the hub, but we really want to and need to accelerate the visibility and the role and the importance of resilience on par with a mitigation agenda. it's absolutely critically important that we catch up to where we need to be in terms of the Paris Agreement and 1.5 agenda in terms of the mitigation. But there's the resilience agenda, understanding the complexity, the funding has fallen way, way behind. So I think as we've worked to create the race to resilience as a sister race to the race to zero, as Nate and Kathy were saying before, there has really yet to be a real key central hub or repository where we could lift up all the action that is happening on resilience. And as Nate said, do that in a way that is holistic, systemic, and transformational. So my hope is that we achieve the goal of lifting resilience to the same level of import and immediacy with which we are taking the mitigation agenda.
One of the reasons why resilience has got to do this dramatic catch up with the mitigation agenda, which is so far further down the track, is that there's a poor understanding amongst leaders politically, in corporations and elsewhere, of what we're really talking about when we say resilience is critical. If you had 3 minutes with any named small group, a lift full, an elevator full of key leaders, and they said, resilience, come on, sort me out on it. What is the essential understanding you'd want them to leave that elevator with? Nate, can you go first on that?
As you point out, mitigation has an advantage, especially in terms of communication. And net zero is pretty easy to communicate the goals of mitigation. But resilience is really about engaging with complexity. And that makes it a difficult thing to communicate with or to communicate. And we look at resilience when we're talking within the Global Resilience Partnership and across our partnership across 5 attributes. So it's diversity, redundancy, connectivity, inclusivity and equity, and adaptive learning. And it really is about, you know, taking an approach that brings together the challenges we're seeing on the ground instead of trying to divide them up into individual topics and address them singularly. We're about actually kind of lumping things together and actually saying things are within a system and we have to build resilience within that system. And so if we take those ideas to, you know, look at responding in multiple ways to systemic changes and shocks and really providing these sources for innovation to emerge, then I think that really encompasses resilience. But it's not something that communicates in 2 words like net zero. So it's certainly a challenge. And but I really do think resilience is coming of age. We're seeing a huge dramatic shift within the communities, within the governments, within the private sector, in recognizing the critical role that resilience plays. And I also think it provides a really critical bridge between adaptation and mitigation. So we can see resilient solutions, often things like nature-based solutions that are both provide a mitigation benefit in terms of carbon sequestration and a resilience benefit or adaptation benefit in terms of improving livelihoods. So I think people are starting to really recognize the critical role that resilience has to play as an equal sibling to mitigation.
2 things. Mitigation is about carbon and adaptation is about people. The race to resilience has for the first time created a human-based metric for the achievements of a resilience agenda and the race to resilience and their initiatives. And so a great piece of evidence is that South Africa is the first country ever to submit a human-based metric in their adaptation commitments in their NDC. And so that is really strong evidence of what Nate said, that resilience is coming of age. But the quick elevator speech is that mitigation is about carbon and adaptation and resilience is about people. And we can measure our impact and we will through the race to resilience and all of the learning and scaling of work that happens in the hub during COP26.
Well, what's happening with regards to climate change, and not just climate change, but urbanization, globalization, and the fourth industrial revolution, these are all global megatrends that are hitting us as a human society at the same time. So resilience encompasses all of these things, and it's a systemic issue again, and holistic view that is so important and so, in some cases, difficult to deal with. One of the words that I would use to kind of lean into this issue is uncertainty. We are dealing with an unprecedented level of uncertainty
based on technological change, urbanization, and again, a rapidly changing climate. So how do we address and protect ourselves for continuity, safety? And this is about everyone, and it is impacting everyone. And we have the responsibility to protect vulnerable communities, global supply chains, but this is only going to happen if we collaborate. You have to share best practices, learn from each other, and I think this is the very role of what the Resilience Hub is all about, why we're delighted to be participating in this, and we're not going to realize the step change that we need in terms of understanding resilience and putting it into practice without that type of collaboration.
Thank you so much, Nate, Kathy, Seth. I wish you a most fantastic fortnight here at the Resilience Hub, and I'm quite sure that the enormous effort that you and your teams have put into bringing this all together will bear all kinds of fruit, not only here, but in the months and years to come.